Are you all candidates for youth or coming for adult education today? Oh, okay, that's good too. Thank you for coming.
And then out of town, but.
Oh, this is what a perfect thing to do.
Yes.
Hopefully this will be a blessing to you. Thank you.
Well, I have a deacon here to fill it.
Oh, I recognize you now, deacon, without your. You gave me communion this morning. Thank you. Thank you for coming.
This is my wife.
Oh, I'm so happy to have you coming. Thank you.
May I ask, are y'all this house?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, and then Norma.
Oh, okay.
You know Norma?
Yeah, from way back.
In high school, I used to teach high school and I was Norma's father.
You're still Norma's father.
No, still Norma's father. Nobody knows.
I'll talk to you later, but I'm not.
My mother-in-law is 92, and she still volunteers at the hospital where she was a nurse, and now she volunteers at the hospital. And her son is the chief of staff. He's a doctor there, but he's still Alma's son. So, that influence goes a long way, and people have been impressed by the experience. So let's take a look at the works of mercy. Pope Francis declared this past year as the Jubilee of Mercy. So in this year of mercy, he called on us, everybody, to rediscover and render fruitful the mercy of God. So the mercy of God is a fact. God has mercy, whether we accept it or not, or whether we respond to it or not. But because we're baptized, we have this call and also the grace to respond to that mercy, to discover it in our lives, and ways to practice it, to render it fruitful. I love that point of view that it's God's mercy is there, but it can't bear fruit. It's like the sower and the seed, right? God is sending the seed out, but it's only going to bear fruit if we are fertile ground. So for the year of mercy, how can we be fertile ground for God's mercy? This year of mercy, the image for me is always opening the door. What's in that garden beyond the door? When the door is closed, then people, can't experience the riches of a garden. How often our church's door is closed to people? And we have made rules to be a barrier to people approaching God's mercy. And Pope Francis in this exhortation is reminding us, open the door. And he even went so far as to say, churches, you should be unlocked. Doors shouldn't be locked. That was a pretty hard one to do, especially whatever neighborhood you were in. But it was very hard. But how? In what ways can we open the door of mercy? Pope Francis is calling us to adopt a merciful lifestyle. It's kind of just a way of approaching the world. And we were saying in the last session when we were talking about building a culture of peace in our homes, that if we build peaceful people in our own, people we can affect, people we can have an influence on, that's going to make a difference in society. Make a difference in society, a more peaceful society that speaks respectfully to one another, that recognizes the goodness of God in a person who's different. And this is where peace comes in the whole world, beginning with the peaceful action of one person to another. Dorothy Day, Father mentioned her in his homily today, that she was a person who had a hard life. And she was converted to be a Catholic. She was an adult, and after she had lived, she had an abortion, she had this terrible struggle in her young years. And out of that pain, out of that brokenness, came a person who was so compassionate to people who were hurting. And she says, this is how it would be judged, is how the people would be.
Oh, it is?
Just because of the fact that, you know, the so Pope Francis, in his writings, has said again and again about how people are hurting, and we need to think about them coming, not, you know, not fully formed and perfected before we talk to them, but they're hurting so badly that we need to go out to them and put the tent up and be a field hospital so that we can treat their wounds where they're at. And then let's talk about, have you got the right papers? You know, have you got the right sacraments? Have you got, have you done all the right processes? Right? So that this is a suffering world, and we have permission from God to treat people with kindness and accept them where they're at. Without fearing that we're watering down the message of Jesus. The message, people know when their lives are messed up. They don't need us to tell them. But they don't know how to come closer to Jesus in order to find their healing. It's going to be through us. It's going to be through us. Trying to achieve holiness can seem like an overwhelming task, but we can take it one step at a time, and it's a lot easier if we do. Let's think small. Start with the small things, and then we're called to see Jesus' face in everyone we encounter, especially those in need of God's love. And so, parent, taking care of a child, changing diapers, cleaning up messes, we might think, well, that has nothing to do with the great things that I want. I want to do great things for them. Well, our great saints, St. Teresa of Little Flower, especially, I think of her little way, that we would recognize that in doing small things, that if we do them with love, then that can make all the difference in the world. Mother Teresa liked to say that too, that you might not be able to come to India and help the dying poor, but if you love your family, you have mercy on your family. That's just as important. And I think we should not brush that off. I think this whole year of mercy that has focused on me. Oh, you're very welcome. And you should just come on in.
Yeah.
There's some more chairs.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm happy that you came. So, doing small things with great love is part of this whole concept, this attitude of mercy that the Pope has invited us to. We want to have mercy not only on others, but on ourselves. It might be the hardest thing to do for us to have mercy on ourselves, to forgive ourselves for our failings, or for the times that we have been unkind, or for maybe we've done serious things wrong. But God is okay with that. He doesn't, he's not, God is not afraid to get his feet dirty. He can call pastors, but I take that to heart too, that he wants people to get their feet, their shoes dirty from being on the street with people. And I think that that's a really good image for us. That you shouldn't worry that that is going to take us farther away from God. If we make friends with people who are not perfect. Because we should be perfect. We're not perfect. Some people might have their great sins, but I have my sins. And so I have to recognize that I first have to love myself before I can give that love to them. unfortunately, when we are struggling and we don't have self-control, that comes out in being very judgmental. It's interesting. Displace the judgment. We can't see well for ourselves, and so we judge other people. So let's take a look at what I'd like to do here with us is to explore the different works of mercy that are classical for Catholics. First one is, it's a work of hungry to feed the hungry, right? So feeding the hungry, that might mean collecting food for the pantry, for the food pantry, sending funds to Catholic resources to help people in Syria who are starving because of the war. That there, we have lots of opportunities to help feed hungry people around the country. And that's a good thing for Christians to do. But also, feeding the hungry might be just working with that little guy to get one vegetable into him. Or feeding the hungry might be planning a family meal in which, you know, yes, you know, it's hard for us to have dinner together, but, you know, let's put this all on our calendar so that we can have dinner together. In November, we have a day where we do that. So, in Atlanta, have you had that trend away from shopping on Thanksgiving? A lot of stores in Baltimore are intentionally closing on Thanksgiving so that people can spend some time. And then even during the football games on Thanksgiving, that this feeding the hungry, this having food around interactions with other people, is very conducive to people coming closer together. So the power of food is something we as Catholics certainly recognize, because we recognize how Jesus can be present to us, really, in the Eucharist, in food. That we recognize him in the breaking of the bread. The first apostles who saw him after the resurrection, it was a meal that they shared, right? In which they recognized Jesus. It wasn't he was walking along with them, teaching them, and they were all moaning and groaning. When they sat down to eat together, they recognized him. So, the first Christians experienced that they carried that over into their celebrations of the Eucharist. That story of the disciples on the way to Emmaus is a testament to us about how the earliest Christians found the importance of the Eucharistic meal and built their church around it. It wasn't part of their religious practices before that. Okay? It's a work of mercy to give drink to the thirsty. I have some statistics here that I thought was great. Millions of people on our planet don't have adequate access to the precious, life-giving element of water. Each year, more than 5 million people die from water-related disease. 2.5 billion people still lack access to improved sanitation, including more than a billion people who have no facilities at all. Just water. The whole concept of building wells is something that Catholics can get involved in. I got a mailing just this week from Catholic Relief Services that they invite you to send a certain amount of a donation that's going to help build one well in one city or one village. What a wonderful project to contribute to. There's a wonderful little book that I highly recommend to you, and I didn't put it on my handout. It's called A Long Walk to Water. And it's a story of, I'll pass it on. A story of a boy from Africa who experienced lack of water and lots of degradation and refugee camps. And eventually he, through his talents, he's recognized in Central America to school. And he has host parents, some place in New York, that help him with his education And he actually is able to go back to Africa and help build well, becomes an engineer. So I gave him a book. But it's still a wonderful, it's just a tiny little book, and it would be wonderful for your reflection on the needs of people for water. Long Walk to Water, it's called. But giving drink to the thirsty might also be an opportunity for us to review our household use of water. You know, are we conserving water? Do we turn off the water when we're not using it? What do you use that water for? Are you mindful of the value of that resource? We need to continually replenish our fluid supply, right? So experts recommend drinking approximately 2 quarts of water each day. So I'd like, for our first opportunity for you to talk to each other, I'd like you to, just with the people around you, to talk about when have you experienced water as a gift? When have you experienced water as a gift?
This might sound kind of strange, and I don't know if people want to do this, but when my daughter's Girl Scout troop, each year we do the Griffin Stream cleanup, where we actually get into the creek beds and clean out the trash. And you know, you go to the tap and you turn the water, you know it's been through all the chemical processing and everything. But just being in that creek bed, and we see just the beauty of nature with the water, but then also see the stuff that people throw in it, just sit there and think, our water is just precious and people don't realize that.
Yeah, I think in that way, like if you see a waterfall or something, but I was thinking when just at the ocean, I guess something, I'd stop drinking water, but I think that's beautiful.
Yeah, maybe I don't see it
as a gift.
I'm not meeting
these. Sometimes if I've been really hot in the summer, it gets
the other time over.
Well, when I live there in Mexico, we didn't get water 24 hours a day because there was only one well for like 3 towns. So each town would get like 4 hours of water. But we live like on a hill, so even though the water was going to the town, I was like the very last one to actually get it because of the low pressure. So I hated doing the dishes because it was always little water. Oh, by the time I was finishing doing something else, like my father, of course, my grandma was like, you need to do the dishes. Okay, I will. And by the time I got there, no water. And I ended up the day with a pile of dishes and more for the next day. So the day I got to do it early, like when cut off, yeah, I was so relieved, finally. I cut the water today.
I'm just listening to you talk about that and being, having grown up and being here in the United States all my life. There's never been, every once in a while, there's an issue where you turn the tap on and there's no water because they cut it off and didn't work or whatever. I can't imagine not having, like, just turn on the tap, you know, and get water and having it restricted. Yeah.
Yeah, and I told my daughter, let's make sure we load it with water. Like, you see the sink overflowing with our dishes. I said, because you know I don't like to do construction anymore. I'm just frustrated. No water.
I guess that is a luxury habit of dishwasher.
My parents just put a dishwasher in their house maybe 5 years ago. When I was growing up,
in my small group, we talked about,
we just always
and some places, they really do. If you have a well,
dishwasher
and
wash them.
If it goes out, you're going to miss your water. But also, we remember as Catholics, you know, water in baptism, you know, that's a wonderful, the beauty of Catholic tradition is that we use physical things that remind us of God, like water and baptism. I was thinking that, you know, just having my husband bring me a cold glass of water when I'm done cutting the grass, or on a family hike, that having water that you've had to carry, it's heavy, right? You recognize you have that water with you. All those things remind us of the importance of giving drink to the thirsty. clothing the naked. Well, the community connection is, you know, like what organizations in your community collect clothing for others? Especially, well, this is Georgia, and you don't collect winter coats. But where I come from, they collect winter coats for people, for children, that kind of thing. So, you know, it's good to know who those organizations are. Sometimes, though, you know, organizations don't need a lot of used clothing. They get tons of it. And even though, you know, some of it gets distributed, sometimes money is better than sending used clothing to people. The one thing that shelters need more than anything is socks, because you can't use used socks and underwear. More than pants or shirts or those kind of things, you get tons of that. But new underwear, new socks, you could have a sock Sunday in your classroom or just your family. Families can do projects, and there's someone who can receive that donation from them. Mm-hmm. But if we talk about bringing that concept of the work of mercy to clothe the naked home, I found this picture of mom going school shopping with her son, clothing the naked, and how that can be a challenge, right? Mm-hmm. For the generations to understand mm-hmm. each other's clothing habits. That it can be a work of mercy to be able to say yes to some styles that your youth want to use, and for them to understand the limits, whatever they may be. You know, the skirt's a little too short, what can we negotiate? Although short skirts are not an issue for girls anymore because they all wear leggings. But but when I was a girl, it was an issue, mini skirts. That is showing my age. So you might have the expressive teen or the squirming toddler on Sunday morning, from budgeting for back to school clothes to going through the closets periodically and donating what you don't need to others. In my family, I come from a big family, 21 grandchildren. And the parents all share the clothes. You know, whenever we get together, there's bags of clothes going to somebody else's house, so that all the cousins are wearing each other's clothes. And just among them, there's a huge sharing of clothing. But they are thinking in terms of sharing with others. And kids see that, you know. We did this too when I had six children. And they would say, who gave me this? Mm-hmm. Because it was coming from a bag. Mm-hmm. Oh, bag clothes, we got bag clothes. So that's kind of a wonderful opportunity. If you have friends, you know, that don't mind sharing clothes, it can be a fun thing. And it teaches kids something.
In Fayette County, I don't know if you guys are Fayette County people, but we have the Clothes Less Travel mm-hmm. thrift store our parish, Holy Trinity, started. It's ecumenical. But they just celebrated their 20th anniversary, and they have given $5.5 million worth of donations, monetary donations to Fayette County organizations through selling items yes. at $1 a piece, $5 a piece. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen anything in there over $10. Uh-huh. And that's how much that has gone through their hands right. in order to create and generate that much money that they've been able to give away.
And think about it.
In fact, the dress I have on
today.
Because I buy all my clothes there too.
think about the time of sharing among all those people from different churches, how much good that did.
Yeah.
God's mercy is abundant.
Mm-hmm.
It's a work of mercy also to shelter the homeless and care for the sick and to visit the imprisoned. I guess I have to fix that sign. Yes, and working for the homeless, yes, we have homeless shelters and ministry to the homeless. Each year, Catholic Charities provides more than 500,000 people housing services, ranging from affordable housing production to homeless street outreach. So supporting your Catholic Charities organization in your diocese is one positive way to help homeless people. So when we think about home, You know, I think about times when I felt homeless. I've never been homeless, but I remember feeling homeless when my husband's job was suddenly transferred and we had to pick up and move to Baltimore from Pittsburgh. And there was, I really felt a little bit of homelessness. Mm-hmm. And if, whenever you've had that experience, maybe you're between houses or something, to recognize in those little hurts that you experience, to help you get, have empathy for people who have that long term. There's a lot of things that make our house home, right? That creates not just an empty space, but all the personal things we bring into it, and also the expressions of our faith, so that people see that we're Christian. And so when we think about homelessness, we should also think about creating a home that is welcoming and comfortable and pretty. But those are all good things to do that help us grow in mercy for other people. So, kind of a stretch. But caring for the sick, of course, you could volunteer like my mother-in-law in the hospital, but giving blood, those are all the things that we can do in the community, but you get the chance to care for the sick all the time with your family members, with your aged parents, or your spouse is ill, your kids are giving you the next cold, that all of those things are really truly an effective work of mercy. Because if you don't do it, who will? Mm-hmm. Right? Your kids have the flu and you're changing the bed sheets twice a night, just remember that, you know, that is that bringing, that's a work of mercy to do that. It's you know, it stinks, but think about Mother Teresa, you're not doing that. So visiting in prison, Pope Francis has showed us through his example about care. He set up showers for the homeless at the Vatican. People can take showers. He visited the imprisoned. I washed the feet of prisoners. He's showing us by example what a great gift he has been to us in putting a human face on the church as a merciful, the theme of the year of mercy is merciful like the Father.
And is today the end? Today's the last day of it? I noticed on
just for this
year. Just for here,
you're closing the door.
Just for this church.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't get that.
The churches, the doors of mercy were open at different times.
Okay.
So just for this church.
So I think when they start the next church year, yeah, it starts, we'll start. But that doesn't mean we have to stop being merciful.
Right.
There is a, in the bulletin this weekend, there is a invitation to help with the jail ministry.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, and it's the telephone is there to call.
Oh, yeah.
And it's not like that hard, I read it. It's just go and main and women, the jail is near here, and it's Lovejoy,
oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it's just visiting with them. Mm-hmm. You just listen, you don't have to do anything.
It's a real eye-opener. Yeah, some people, you know, if you feel called to that, they provide you some training, and somebody who has experience will go with you. So maybe that's, if that's on your heart, that you can make that proposal.
Yeah, and Joyce over in the, where the vendors are with Visual Dynamics, she has a book on prison ministry too, that some, she has had somebody write. She's, it's one of the newer ones that she's got.
We have one lady that does that, and she brings us prayers to our prayer group from them.
Oh, that's a great thing.
Oh, that's good.
She goes and gets the prayers, and we pray over the, you know, whatever they ask.
Well, that's great. That's wonderful. So if somebody is a volunteer to the people in jail, they can bring those prayer intentions back to their friends.
Mm-hmm.
That's a very good way of paying that forward. It's a work of mercy to instruct the ignorant, right? The catechists are teaching young people, working with adults, teaching them about our faith. But at home, we're just teaching our children basic things like tying their shoes. But that's a work of mercy to to bring people along to have more knowledge about basic things, not just about religious things. Of course, we want them to know about Jesus and the Bible, but also how to get along and be independent. The whole tying of your shoes is a very important step toward independence, which is very important for maturity. That the Christian faith is about growing in maturity. As we become more mature, we become more able to give back. Right? A child needs care, but the goal of life is to give care. It's important to receive care, but the goal of life is also to give care. It's a work of mercy to counsel the doubtful. You know, preaching the gospel at all times and necessary use words, they say. There's some certain qualities that a person who's going to be a friend and counselor should have, like being able to listen without judgment, being willing to learn, willing to learn. You catechists had to spend time planning lessons, and so forming ourselves to be able to recognize when people are in trouble, recognize what they're saying to us, and to respond like Jesus would with mercy. But if people are in real trouble, I think that we want to refer them to an appropriate person. If they're troubled with the law or someone is hurting them, we can't solve that ourselves. We don't have to do it alone, but we should read up on, as I said in our keynote, read up on, you know, what the resources are in the community. And it might be just a matter of sharing with friends, like you knew about the resale shop. People might not know about that. So referring to people who can help them. It's a work of mercy to admonish the sinner. We want to show our political leaders and our community leaders what we think so that they can lead us well. It's important to vote, right? As we did. And also to work against some of the society's ills, like pornography is a big problem, and that there are people who are working to change that on the internet. You could get involved with that. Or environmental hazards, water, waste, that kind of thing. So admonishing the sinner could be speaking out about these important issues in your community. Now at home, admonishing the sinners is about discipline with love. And that's the, I think, maybe if you grew up with corporal punishment in your home, to unlearn that and to find a loving way to guide somebody to the better way. Right. I don't want to run out of time. Click through all this. So,
yes, we have till 12:35.
Oh, okay.
35, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, good. Well, let me, I want to talk about this. I think communication is very important for us to be able to show mercy in our families. And we want communication to last. This is a reminder. First listen, ask questions, ask to make sure you understand what's going on. Sort out your own emotions and the message you want to give. And if you don't know an answer, if somebody asks you a question, it's okay to say, you. And then after you have listened, ask questions and sort of then talk, and with respect at the person's level. So being an askable adult. And that means managing our own prejudices and our own preconceptions. To try to grow an empathy and understanding about people. If we are encountering people that are not like our family of origin, to learn about their culture. And to find out what makes them tick, what's important to them, what their what they value, and share what you know, where you're coming from, and your culture with other people. I think that is something that is a work of mercy in the world today, because we are not going to have the ability to ignore each other. And it wasn't ever a good idea for us to be separate from each other. We should always have been building this understanding and respect for one another. It used to be the oceans kept us apart, right? Mm-hmm. And people have stayed on their continents, and they were. But now, I think it's God's providence that we're able to come together and learn from each other, because we have this, what Pope Francis called that challenging mosaic of the differences. That's how heaven has got to be. Heaven has got to be this challenging mosaic of all of this beauty. I think, and to find ways to explore that even further. It's a work of mercy to bear wrong patiently and to forgive offenses willingly. This can be hard, because sometimes people aren't ready to change. And so it's very hard for us to forgive them. It's what the church teaches as well. Forgiveness is of the heart, but it does not necessarily mean that we can be reconciled with that person. That reconciliation is something that has to be earned by that person responding back. So forgiveness is a gift that removes hatred from the equation. But sometimes you aren't going to be able to continue relating to that person because they are dangerous, or they just can't respect you. And that's okay. And we should teach children, you shouldn't say, you must forgive. You can say, I'm sorry. But sometimes that other person is not worthy of us coming close to them again. And we should be aware of the difference. Do you have a question about that?
Could you explain a little bit more about what you just said?
Well, sometimes when people are...
So you don't want to go in the same situation if the other person has not recognized that he needs to make a change from their behavior or whatever, the two people of that new behavior.
Right, so that you explained it very well. That if someone will not change, then it's very important for you to take care of yourself. And being a Christian doesn't mean that you become a doormat. That forgiveness frees you from the oppression. That if the other person is not going to change, then you need to stay safe. And so that's what the church teaches us, that forgiveness doesn't mean that you have to take...
We just pray for the person.
And you can pray for the person. You can get counseling for yourself to help you to deal with your situation. But maybe that other person is not able to change. You can pray for them. Maybe somebody else is going to be able to reach them. But very often, if someone is being nasty to you, they're striking out at you, but there's something in themselves that they really hate. They externalize that on the person that's closest to them. So there's no redemption. You know, it's not redemptive suffering to let somebody beat on you. It's very important for you to value your own human dignity and other people around you, like children. So it's tough because we're trained to be forgiving, right? But God is the one who can always forgive. God is the one. But having mercy on a person might be removing yourself from the situation so they're going to have to face up to their own problems without having you as an easy target. That could be a work of mercy. You're going to forgive their offenses, but not put yourself in danger. Bearing wrongs patiently, I think that comes along not with someone abusing you personally, but times in a situation you can't change, you don't get the respect that you deserve, maybe at work, that maybe patience would help you change the situation gradually. So these works of mercy don't mean becoming a doormat. It's a fine distinction, but very important one. And the key is that your own human dignity, that is, doesn't go away with the entire human dignity. Question? Okay,
I think that's really hard today because of all of the variations of what is right and wrong, and through one's eyes might determine that this is wrong, but through another person's eyes, they determine that that is right. And so that patience to hold your ground or to stand your ground and not to violate the other person, but I think in my experiences, there are a lot of people who think they're right. And in my upbringing, I think they're wrong.
People these days, they do think that rainbow or choosing. And I always tell you now, it's black and white. There's not in between. So but that's what people think. You can choose from all these, and it's not. Is it right or wrong?
So the thing that is always right is to treat people with respect,
right,
and love.
Yes.
To treat everyone, whatever their situation, with kindness and respect. That will go a long way to understanding them, for them to being able to hear you, to maybe they need to make a change. Mm-hmm. So we can act now to live a more merciful life and practice mercy at home, just by, you know, spending more time together, to simplifying our schedules, and just eating and spending peacefully, just in our practice. That this would be a way to put these works to mercy into practice in our daily life. And it will filter out into how we do it in our work and in our community. It's a work of mercy to bury the dead and to comfort the sorrowful and to pray for the living and the dead. So much good can come from going to someone's funeral. They will love you forever for coming to their mother's funeral. You might not have known her very well, but if you think about it, you could have great ramifications for you to be with people at that time. And you think, well, I just, you know, got in the car and I went to church and I said I'm sorry. But you don't know how much mercy that you're carrying with you. It's like you're carrying with you God's mercy. And you look at it that way. And you don't have to pat yourself on the back, because you're just being an agent of God's mercy in all of these things. So praying for the dead, comforting people who are sad. And I think we don't have to have answers for people in these situations. People say, well, I don't know what to say, you know. And actually, you don't really, it'd be better to say nothing. And when people are sorrowful or people have experienced a death, that they really just are comforted by our presence. Mm-hmm. We don't have to say, you know, God wanted another angel, or that there must be a reason, or God is going to, you know. No, don't speak for God. God is speaking for himself. That when we're with people who are suffering, that we shouldn't presume to know what God does not need us to speak for them, or to come up with, you know, some theological reason for their suffering, because this is not what God needs us to do. He needs us to be present, to walk along with people, and to listen to them, to give them an ear, and you're not going to be able to make sense of something that.
Yeah, I hear people say sometimes, well, God never gives us anything we can't handle or something like that. And I think, gosh, I'm glad I believe in the God I believe in, because my God's a God of goodness. And my God doesn't send bad to anybody. And, you know, I want to clarify the theology, but I don't. But, you know, that just isn't what Catholics believe. Catholics believe we have a good God. And on that day when he made humans, it was very good. And so what? Why would we think God would send us bad things? Life sends us bad things.
I think that for me the key is you don't have to speak for God.
Yeah,
you don't have to make excuses for God. God is able to speak for himself. So when I'm with someone who's sorry, I just say I'm sorry.
That's really good because that's something that we go every time something happens.
Very often you'll hear people say, but he was such a good person, how could he? But that God did not strike him down because he wasn't right. it's better to let God speak for himself and to us be the presence of God's mercy. And it takes us off the hook because we don't have to figure out There are lots of practices that can help us grow to be a merciful person. We can make pilgrimages, right? Go to local shrines, take your family with you, and we can teach children about being a person of prayer, but also being a person of mercy by doing these practices. Certainly the hospitality that we accord to everyone. I will remember from my time with Father's old saying about our guest in the home has gotten home. Mm-hmm. Keeping Sabbath, I mean really trying to keep Sabbath, besides going to church, but carve out Sunday to just keep it special. Make it for visiting friends or visiting family. And I grew up in a Jewish community. And the stores were all closed on Saturday. There was no shopping because it was Saturday. Right? And that made a big impression on me that, boy, these people are so, faithful that they are willing to close their stores on Saturday. Because I guess I'm old enough to remember when stores were closed on Sunday, but they were pretty early in my life. So to say, do I have to go to the store today? Let me, do I have to cut the grass today? Sunday, maybe it won't rain tomorrow. But you do what you can, of course, and it's not so rigid rule. But to make Sabbath space for yourself. People can, ordinary people, we can fast. That means not having that second drink, eating less, mindful of people around me. Prayer, service, all of these things are ways that we can practice living a merciful life. So, raising people, if we do this, we live this way, we're going to raise merciful people. To be merciful like the Father.
And your son?
And my son.
Aww, what a cute picture.
So the next generation will benefit from the acts that we do. Okay, thank you very much.
Oh, thank you.
That's awesome. So I have